Okay. Well, thank you everyone for coming to this, the second episode of Structures, Describing a System in Real Time. My name is Prem Krishnamurthy, and we'll be doing this every week through Home Cooking, a collective of artists spread throughout the world until September 29th. Now, I hope it's been a good week for you so far. For those of you in the United States, I hope that you enjoyed Labor Day and the real start of the season. For those of you outside of the USA who might not understand what Labor Day is, let's just say that in the USA, as in many things, we try to do things a little bit differently. Like, we don't want to celebrate Workers' Day on May 1st, like Europe and the rest of the world. So now we'll move it to September to make sure it's not lined up with the International Workers' Day, because it might become a little too political, you know, that kind of stuff. But really, I mean, I actually ought to correct myself, because I said, I hope you have enjoyed Labor Day before, but actually, I should probably say, to be accurate and honest, I hope you will enjoy Labor Day, because, you know, actually, as usual, I'm actually recording this session beforehand on Sunday, September 6th, but it's being live streamed to YouTube and Twitch on Tuesday, September 8th. So that I can focus more on the actual performance of responding to everyone's comments and all of your questions in the chat. So thanks for that. Keep them coming. If you want, just type something right now in the comments and I will respond to it. But yeah, I know. I'm sorry. It does make for a little bit of a confusing temporality. Are we before or after and all that? And yeah, I know. Time is a funny concept. Maybe we'll get into that at some point. I mean, yeah, my notes say scratch head. So let me do that. Well, anyways, I'm really looking forward to our conversation today. This is my little fireside chat or something like that. Maybe I need one of those little videos of logs burning and a green screen in the background, but I'm not quite that high tech. I mean, but for those of you who couldn't join the first episode, let me just give you a quick recap. We just covered the basics. I mean, we started out talking about David Allen and his management self-help classic, Getting Things Done, which offers a comprehensive, though sometimes a bit too totalizing, system for an approach to organizing one's work, life, and, well, everything. And then we talked a little bit about Things, my task management software, and really my favorite app. It's the main reason why I stay on the Mac and iOS platforms. Thank you, Cultured Code in Stuttgart, for developing Things. Oh, and I just want to be clear. I receive absolutely no sponsorship or anything from Things or David Allen or Getting Things Done. I mean, actually, I've written the Things team a whole bunch of times to say, hey, my name is Prem, and I'm doing a 5-part performance conceptual lecture series based solely on the tags functionality of your app, which I love. And if you'd like to join me, I'd love to see you here. But they haven't really gotten back to me yet. I mean, it's still after Labor Day, so give them a couple of days. You know, everyone has to take some time off for holidays. But, you know, David Allen on the other end, I have to say, he was very kind to write me back. He actually, true to his reputation, seems to respond to nearly every email I've written him in 2 minutes or less. I mean, that's actually one of his maxims, which is that if you have a task in front of you that takes 2 minutes or less, then don't put it off. Do it right now. So he's going to be joining as a special guest on the last episode of the series that'll be aired on September 29th, where we can ask him some questions and talk about Things and Structures. So for those of you who did join last time, you probably started to get a sense of my format approach. It's very easy. I'm going to open up my tags in my Things software, my Things app, and then we'll talk about the internal categories and structures that order my work in life. I mean, it's pretty loose, but the idea is that hopefully there's a little something in there for everyone. That maybe there's some tip or tool or thought that this will spark. And so if everything goes right, it'll take about, you know, another 40, 45 minutes or so. And then, you know, we'll have a little fun along the way. So let's get started. Now, before we actually jump into the things, let me just do something quick. I always like people to do something embodied when they start an event. And so I'm adapting a practice from Resma Menakem, a Minneapolis-based trauma specialist and therapist. And it's a practice that he particularly recommends for what he calls bodies of culture, when they come into a new space in order to relax their bodies and make sure that they know things are safe. But I think it's a really useful tool for us to all practice as we enter into this unfamiliar space together. So I'll just ask you to take a moment and stare straight in front of you and just take a moment to breathe. Breathe in, out, and out again. And just notice what's landed in your consciousness. And slowly, I want you to just look over your left shoulder, pivoting your shoulders and your hips. And then you can slowly come back to center. Keep breathing. Slowly look up. And slowly bring your head to look down. And then come back to center. And now I want you to just turn and look over your right shoulder, again, pivoting your shoulders and your hips. And then turn back around and come back to center. Thank you, Resma Menakem, for that fantastic practice. Okay, let me share my screen and we'll get started. Okay, so here again is my complete list of things categories. We'll start, we finished with maxims last week, so let's start with themes. Okay. This is just a set of themes that I'm interested in. So let's start with activism. I've written activism here with a lowercase a, since it's more the kind that I practice, but I'm also interested in it with a capital A. So you know what? Actually, I should probably just go ahead and change that. The great thing about tags and things is that they're very fluid. I can turn that into a capital A activism with just a couple clicks. Alien life. Now, I'm pretty sure that my mom is a big supporter of SETI, the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, so I should ask her about this. But I do know that since she was a software engineer and a roboticist, she was really interested in science fiction, and aliens were a constant theme of my childhood. Nowadays, though, I'm much less interested in externalities and the search for alien life outside of the globe, and more interested in examples like the evolution of octopus intelligence and how it might represent a different mode of consciousness from that we understand to be the human mode of consciousness. Now, I feel embarrassed to say that I really only took one anthropology course in college, and it was called Civilization and Collapse. And actually, to be honest, I think it was actually cross-listed with archaeology. I say I'm embarrassed because my wife has a master's degree in visual anthropology, and learning and working from her has made me realize that I probably should have learned anthropology first before anything else. I mean, the self-reflexive study of humans and human society in all their beautifully varied and contradictory forms is ingrained deeply in me and my practice, but I hope that I still have some time to learn. So it's funny that the difference between working in and someone else's archive and working on your own is a big one. I mean, when I'm working in someone else's archive, especially if it hasn't yet been processed, that is categorized and organized according to a system other than the one that it was delivered in by whichever institution of knowledge and power holds it. Well, when I'm working in an archive, I find it extremely fascinating to note the tiny juxtapositions of different objects, like say a type sample here with the flyer from the 1930s film together with a manuscript for a lecture and a photographic study that are all together in what the Germans called a Konvolut, which just means it's a German word for a bundle, like a stack or a sheaf of papers. But there's not necessarily an order to it. It just happened to be there together by serendipity, or maybe there's some intention, but who knows? Well, on the other hand, though, in the case of my archive, which in theory is currently being processed right now up at Bard College in Annandale on Hudson in New York State, I know that I would at least claim that there's really very little. There are existing structures, but none of them matter. That the only thing that's important about that archive is that it's a collection of 50 boxes of work and writings and objects from over 20 years of work. And I'm mostly interested in how it's going to be disassembled, reassembled, and then ultimately used by others in the future. Artificial intelligence. I'm sure I'm not the only person in the room who's very interested in AI right now, especially after the release of GPT-3 in June, which my friend Christopher Coulandrin Thomas told me with great excitement was the most important event of 2020. My mom, though, was always convinced that we'd get to actual artificial intelligence and sentience before long. I mean, I don't know, we'll see, but it's probably not the first time that she's been well ahead of me. Now, the idea of artists as healers and healers as artists is one that resonates in many cultural contexts. I mean, whether we're thinking about shamanical traditions or the connections of alchemy, magic, healing, and art, or to think about the spiritual roles of art as a way to create connections, community, and communion. But more specifically, in the 20th century, I'm also interested in particular figures who moved out of a more professionalized artistic practice to become therapists or healers or organizers of some kind. One of my favorite and kind of foundational figures in my work and thinking is Chauncey Hare. I'll give you just a quick capsule bio. I'm probably going to get a couple facts wrong, so don't quote me on this. But, you know, here's the basic outline. I mean, he was a trained engineer who was born in the Rust Belt. He was a trained engineer who worked for Standard Oil in the Bay Area, although he completely hated his job at some point. And he then started traveling around the country photographing folks inside of their homes in the 1970s. He'd literally knock on their door and say, "Can I come in and photograph you at home?" And he did this in order to show the deep-seated alienation that people in America felt that was created by corporate interests. And he then received multiple Guggenheim grants in a row, which I think was pretty unprecedented. And then he had solo shows at all these museums, including SF MoMA and the Museum of Modern Art in New York. Though the story that I was told, maybe apocryphal, maybe not, was that he actually handcuffed himself in protest to the guardrails at the opening of his SF MoMA show because he found out the show was sponsored by Philip Morris. And so, you know, but he then ended up leaving the art world entirely out of disgust with corporate interests and became an occupational therapist with his second wife and partner. And this is just one tiny bio of many. I also think of figures like Charlotte Poznanska or Lygia Clark or others who Andrea Fraser, I know, is also trained as a psychoanalyst. But all of these figures who have moved deliberately and with self-awareness from an artistic practice, an individual creative practice, into a therapeutic practice, embedding this explicitly individual or creative part of their approach into their clinical or healing work. And I mean, if any of you have any ideas or references for people I should research, please just put them here in the comments. Like right now, just, you know, type into the comments. I think it's on that side, actually, depending on your interface. Just type into the comments, and I would love to gather those things. Who isn't interested in belonging? I don't think I have to say a lot more there. Now, my dear friend and mentor, the polymathic artist and writer Brian O'Doherty, coined the term the white cube in the late 1970s to describe the modernist construct of the white cube gallery space, a a fictional space of neutrality that eliminates all of the impure presences of everyday life to turn the business of showing and nowadays, even more importantly, of selling contemporary art into something that is nearly sacred. And that is definitely a very, very important value. And again, not only cultural, often monetary. And we're in 2020, and you think that it'd be well time to move past the idea of an objective, neutral, non-ideological white cube. I wish that that were such an obvious statement today that I could delete it from my themes. But unfortunately, looking around me at the exhibitions being made today, I think we still have a couple of years to go. Now, for those of you who were here last week, you may have seen in my maxims, one of them is that true care is for the self as well as for others. Now, when I was a child and I was very stressed out, I used to do this thing with my throat, this very low voice that was comforting to me. Who knows what it did? Maybe it tickled some nerves in my body, but maybe we can all just do this together. Just please join in with me if you like. Yeah, I've noticed my niece does that too. Who knows where we learn these things? So I'm going to quote Octavia E. Butler's protagonist from Parable of the Sower, which you might, I might add, it just hit the New York Times bestseller list last week. It was written in 1993, published in 93, but yeah, go OEB up in the stars. Yeah, hitting the New York Times. We've been manifesting. So anyways, her protagonist is Laura Oya Olamina, a young teenage girl who has a vision of a kind of religion or a spiritual movement that might take her and her family or her friends out of the situation that they're in. But I'll just read the first lines from her books of Earthseed. All that you touch, you change. All that you change, changes you. The only lasting truth is change. God is change. Anecdotally, my own social media handle is at Vexelmann, Vexelmann, which was my crude translation about 15 or 20 years ago to German of a man of change. Climate collapse. Whew, that's a heavy one. Why don't we all just take a moment to breathe deeply in and slowly breathe out. You can do it again. Collaboration. No work is made by a single person. Everything requires cooperation. But I'm always curious, what are the power dynamics of such relations? And how can they be mutually transformative, not just functionalized and turned into something for one person's benefit? This, I think, is where collaboration comes in. Okay, I still have a lot of reading to do on consciousness. It's been, you know, 20, 25 years since I read any philosophy of the mind. I'm getting started again. But if the author Michael Pollan is right in any way, maybe I need to also try a little bit of psilocybin-sparked research on this subject soon. Dance. Oh, well, you know, I believe dance is really important. I'm sure I've talked about Barbara Ehrenreich's Dancing in the Streets, which is I'm finishing right now, but dance, really, really, really important for bringing people together. So wait, let me just try to stop this screen share and switch to something else. How do you feel? Hope that was a little bit of a good body-mind synchronizing exercise. Let's keep going. I need a little water, actually. It's getting hot here. Okay, so where were we? Dance. So DDR design. DDR here stands, DDR stands for Deutsche Demokratische Republik, which is the German term for what's known in English as the GDR or former East Germany. I spent a year of my life from 99 to 2000 based in Dresden, Germany on a Fulbright fellowship. And I was working with Professor Jörg Petruschat as my advisor. And my project, which I proposed and developed over the course of this year, was that I traveled around the whole of former East Germany to meet with and conduct extremely long-form interviews with mostly industrial designers and architects, but other different folks from the design fields who had been active under socialism to understand how their lives and their work had changed through the transformations of 1989. But also, I wanted to record photographically how these changes actually manifested themselves in their physical workplaces and homes, both before and after what's known in German as Die Wende. This is literally the change. And for me, it was a way to understand how design might be produced under an entirely different social and economic and political system, rather than under the constraints of the system that I happened to be born within. Developmental psychology. Let's just call this an old and new interest. I mean, this is an easy one. Who's not interested in difference? Diversity. Embodied practice. You know, if you'd asked me 5 years ago how I would describe my relationship to mind and body questions, I usually answered, I'd standard line. I'd say, I'm a brain in a vat. I mean, which wasn't entirely true. I always loved dancing. I did lots of things, but I just didn't think about my brain and mind and body connected anyways. Now, I'm lucky that through the friendship and knowledge of folks like the designer and mover Emily Smith, or the artist and somatic therapist Susan Plotz, or the therapist and choreographer Krista Coccioli, and many, many others, I can safely say that I was extremely wrong about myself, at least. And Emily Smith summed it up best a couple months ago. Some of you might remember this from my maxims last week. The brain also feels, it just calls it thinking. Exhibition display. So when we're rethinking the white cube, I think we also need to rethink how things are framed in a space, whatever space that might be, whether physical or on a screen. I'm working on futures, because I really would like there to be some of these for folks to come. Now, gifts. I mean, there's definitely a great theoretical dimension here. My colleague, designer and writer Rob Giampietro, wrote a great essay years ago on Lewis Hyde's canonical book, The Gift. And I can recommend that in addition to reading the Hyde book itself, which really thinks about gift giving as a creative, artistic act, but also one that through its reciprocity, and I would argue the potential for mutuality, that this can create the possibility for community. This whole idea is a very basic theme and part of my life in terms of everything I'm thinking about. But also on a very just everyday level, like I'm the guy who buys 1 or 10 or 100 copies of book to give to his friends because he thinks that they'll really enjoy it. And you know, I might be wrong. I mean, I hope people don't think it's annoying that I always give them books, but I just love these books, and so I give them to people, and I think maybe they'll get something out of it too, and I hope that they'll tell me when they have books that they recommend. So maybe any of you in the comments over there, you guys, just, you know, write in the comments if you got any books you think that you would give to 100 people, then please tell me, because I'm sure I'd like to be one of those 100 people. So, I mean, but most recently, these books were things like Bessel van der Kolk's The Body Keeps the Score, but probably the next one will be Julia Cameron's The Artist's Way, or, you know, a couple of years ago in 2017, it was Ted Chiang's Stories of Your Life and Others, or in 2018, it was Adrienne Murray Brown's Emergent Strategy, or when it was 2014, in the wake of the murder of Michael Brown and thinking about racism in America, but also racism and class more generally, it was Zia Hyder Rahman's In the Light of What We Know, or, you know, more recently, I've also been giving some self-help books to friends like David Allen's Getting Things Done, or Kim Scott's Radical Candor, or even that more or less first classic self-help book, Dale Carnegie's How to Win Friends and Influence People, which actually, even though its title sounds really sleazy, I do think it's actually just a book in empathy. It's just a book that if you want to be able to convince people of the things that you want in the world, you actually just need to listen to them and figure out the mutual space that where you can both fulfill your needs. So, but anyways, I mean, yeah, I'm the guy always giving books. But when I was younger, probably when I was 8 or 10, you know, my mom's best friend, and I, you know, I'll never know if she did this as a joke or if this was really serious, but, you know, she asked me if she could have my entire collection of statues of the elephant-headed Hindu god Ganesha, a collection that I painstakingly collected from relatives in India, you know, since I was probably 4 or 5 years old. And, you know, my 8 or 10 year old self, without any hesitation, I just gave her the whole collection. This is very related to the one above. It's just here, it's a verb, a continuous process, rather than just the thing that's given. Healing. I mean, it goes without saying, but I'll say it. I think we all need a lot of this these days. So I never actually finished reading Jacques Le Goff's History and Memory, but it still stays on that set of books that are kind of supposed to be really canonical to me. I mean, my high school best friend, Liz Gomer, recommended it to me decades ago, but never finished it. Go figure. So I often talk about the ideology of displays, or more generally of interfaces. And I mean, you know, every display has an ideology that it supports and furthers. And if we forget this, then we also forget the reasons why things are made and what their goals are. And so, you know, it applies to every interface, like the one I'm using right now. I mean, the means by which we interact with any kind of experience, digital, analog, spiritual, they're all created with a particular agenda in mind, however subtle and embedded that is. And, you know, as much as we must use every interface, every display, every structure that allows us access to experiences, because there's nothing that is without that interface or display. There's no pure phenomena. I think it's also important to consider how these interfaces were made, by whom, and to whose benefit they were made. That might help us to have a different relationship to them. All right. I mean, I know we've been here for a while. I'm getting a little tired, but, you know, I need to break the structure of reading this, like, you know, kind of script I wrote myself a couple of hours. I mean, but I should also say it takes a structure to break one. I mean, you know, that's something I learned years ago when I used to play a lot of jazz music in high school. I mean, for example, people often think of improvisation, that's something that's purely spontaneous, and that's really a fiction. I mean, because at least from my experience in jazz, playing guitar, you always have a structure. There's a song, there's a standard, there's a set of chord changes, there's even just a kind of set of modal chords that are playing, even if they're, you know, in long form, over which, or in dialogue which with which you are improvising. So improvisation, freedom, is always in dialogue with structure or constraints. And, you know, this you can hear, for example, if you listen to like 10 takes of somebody like John Coltrane playing night after night at a club like the Village Vanguard, the same songs, he will often use the same figures in some ways in structuring his improvisatory solos over, say, My Favorite Things. But there's always variations. So I think that this idea that there's something purely spontaneous that's not conditioned is a problem. But on the other hand, in order to really improvise, you have to be able to let go of that structure a little bit. And I was thinking about this recently, like I was telling this to my wife last night, you know, when I was going through a couple years ago, all the crap in my parents' attic, excuse my language, and, you know, found all these papers from high school. And I found the evaluation from high school from when I auditioned for the all-state jazz band on guitar. And, you know, I played some standard, some jazz standard, and then I did a little, you know, solo and I improvised. And they wrote me in the comments, I probably got something like a 3.5 out of 5, a 4 out of 5. But the comment was so telling. It said, don't overthink the, or it said, the concept is there, don't overthink it. Now, I've been saying a lot of times, I here. I could also say we. I mean, as one of the maxims that I mentioned last week with Richard Bartlett, every person is many people. But I think I is also a useful position sometimes. And it's important for me that I say here, individual and collective, not individual versus collective, as things are sometimes set up, because I think there's no actual necessary contradiction between the two. I mean, you know, as I said, I think every person is many people, and in fact, but also a collective is a body, but it also consists of individual parts, which are symbiotic. And there's something that the artist Grace DeRitu said to me a while back that was very telling. She said, to be part of an experimental community, you have to be clear about your own boundaries. And, you know, I sometimes frame this as, to be a good member of a collective, you also have to be a good individual. Intuition. I don't think we're going to get through this whole list today, but let's keep going for a little bit. Joy. Okay, I mean, this is the big one. This is really like, this is why we're all here, right? This is why we're all still alive, why we haven't decided to end the whole thing. I mean, it's what the goal is for each of us individually, but also collectively. So, you know, and some of us have the privilege and the luck and the good fortune to be better able to access and participate in their own joy. And I think that what that means is that those folks have the responsibility, but also the pleasure of being able to help make those tools available to others and to support others in their access to joy. Klaus Wittkugel. So Klaus Wittkugel, he was born in 1910, and he was arguably the most significant and surely, you know, best and most recognized official graphic designers of the DDR, of the former East Germany. And he made a brilliant body of modernist work that is rigorous yet very eclectic, that included posters, book jackets, propaganda exhibitions, visual identities, pictogram systems, stamps, coins, films, and more until he died in 1985. And one thing that's important is that in East Germany, you were not allowed to have a design firm. He couldn't have employees. So in fact, he did this work together with his students, each of who were paid separately by a client and were never organized into a studio structure. But I think here the question of individual and collective is quite important. He taught for decades, and he brought the tools of being a socialist monteur to successive generations of graphic designers and visual artists in East Germany. But he's not very well known today. And probably that's A, because he died just before the advent of the Cold War. And you know, you're still on the losing side of history. So there wasn't that much motivation to resuscitate and research his work. I mean, so in 2008, I discovered his 1978 monograph in an antiquarian bookstore in Boston. And I began this deep dive into his work and his archives. I mean, I came to Germany. I was the first person to really go through those archives, and when they were processed, they're still not entirely processed, but to start to identify things and to meet his colleague and his networks and the people who were still around, to interview them, to look at his graphic design work, to research his work as an exhibition maker. And, you know, in particular, I'm interested in how his work challenges some of our existing ideas about the role of design and its agency. Particularly around its relationship to ideology. So, you know, folks might criticize designers like Wittkugel for having worked on political propagandistic causes and for, you know, a repressive socialist government. But I'd like to ask, like, who's to say that those more canonized Western modernist designers who worked for major corporations in the 1950s and 60s and 70s, and, you know, mind you, these are many of the same corporations that appear from our perspective in 2020 to have contributed massively to the world's current economic, environmental, and social inequalities and precarities, who's to say that they were any better? LARP. Now, I mean, if I were going to be more specific, I would actually say Nordic LARP. LARP stands for live action role playing, but Nordic LARP or progressive LARP indicates the more Northern European, but also more progressive strand of the field that sees it less as a form of like mass entertainment. Like people might have a vision of, you know, dudes with Nerf swords or something. No, I mean, Nordic LARP or progressive LARP sees role playing as a kind of more serious, intellectual, conceptual, and even socially engaged area of practice, even if it can still be fun. And, you know, it's like a form, Susan Plutz actually once described as a form of experimental improvisatory theater where there's no audience, only participants. And I think about it even more functionally as a way to dismantle and construct again social norms, rules, and roles in a collaborative way where everybody agrees from the beginning on what the rules are and to follow them within the frame of the game. And so, you know, I'll back up even more and say, like, as a young person, my favorite hobbies were really tabletop role-playing games like Dungeons and Dragons and others. I mean, these were games where a bunch of friends would sit around and we'd create an entire world collectively and then play out fictional roles in them. But, you know, for those of you there who were there in the 80s and 90s, I mean, this was probably the least cool thing you could possibly have done in a small town in the 1980s and 90s in America, particularly, you know, as a guy who looks the way I do. And so it definitely hindered my already slim possibility of ever dating another human being. And so, you know, I kind of got rid of that stuff at some point because I realized that I had to keep my priorities straight. But fast forward to 2018, when I found out through Susan Plutz, Susan Plutz actually was running an Octavia Butler-inspired live-action role-playing game, a LARP, at the Gropius Bau in Berlin, inspired by Xenogenesis. And so I suddenly found out that LARP had become cool, and artists were into it, and people thought it was, like, really sexy and stuff. And so that really blew my mind. And yeah, it's been a couple of years, but I've been dipping my toes in with some research, and, you know, serious play can be fun, too. A couple of months ago, I was chatting with my friend, the artist Julie Moretu, and she used the word liberation, which, to be honest, it tripped me up a bit. I mean, I come from a first generation immigrant, South Indian, Hindu, Brahmanical family that was organized deeply around the constraints and constructions of obedience, obligation, and duty. And so when she used the word liberation, to be honest, my whole body tensed up. I was like, what kind of hippie idea is that? I mean, you know, I was also raised to not like hippies. I mean, I think it was something about my dad having been a foreign student at Berkeley in the 1960s, but not even knowing that there were protests going on. But also the sense that somehow hippies were wild, that they were wild and unorganized and did drugs. And, you know, they might even have appropriated a bunch of stuff from, you know, our Hindu heritage. So, you know, but then, you know, when Julie said this, I took a deep breath again, as I try to do whenever, you know, my body has that kind of tensed up response. And I, you know, just started to ask myself, what am I afraid of here in this word, liberation? Anyways. So actually my sister studied linguistics in college. That was her major. And she, you know, she always got to everything first. And then she also did it better than me, though I have the advantage of having continued on these paths for longer. So I'm a little bit like the tortoise and she's the hare. Though, I mean, you know, I really won. But no, I'm not trying to say it's a competition, though, you know, maybe I should add sibling rivalry into the themes. I mean, it's covered a little bit under developmental psychology, but I still got a couple words to learn. Now, literary theory, yeah, so when I went to Yale in the 90s, after my sister had already been there for a bunch of years, everybody read theory. And that was really fine with me back then because, you know, I loved theory. I mean, it was like, throw me some deconstruction, throw me some post-structuralist thinking. Let me read my Ferdinand de Saussure, you know, give me some more Jacques Derrida. I could get into Harold Bloom. And yeah, let me even read Paul Dumont, whom I found out later had a very shady Nazi era past. Let me read him in translation in German, even though the original was in English. Damn, yeah, I'm gonna do that. Give me some more white dudes. I'm gonna eat them all up. Well, you know, so this was like my kind of enthusiasm, but it took me a little bit to get out of that rut. I mean, I actually really owe it to my great high school friend and present day, you know, English literature professor and writer, Timothy Aubrey, who he used to go to all the professional conferences for literary academic folk and stay up on the stuff. And I used to say, Tim, here's the way I see it. I mean, by the time a particularly sexy kind of new theory or approach makes it into the design discourse, it's already like 5 years late, because it means if it got to design, graphic design, it means it was already in the architecture discourse a year or two before. And before that, it was in the contemporary art and art history discourse. And then even before that, it was all the rage in the literary theory conversation. So what I need you to do is tell me now what all of you English professors and comp lit folks are thinking and reading about, so that I'm at least 5 years ahead of the curve, okay? And so, oh yeah, I mean, like in winter I asked him this and he gave me some Carolyn Levine, her book Forms, and it's been rocking my world. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Now, methodologies. Pretty easy. If you don't have tools to study the tools that you use, then what's the point anyways? Now, okay, we've been going for a while. It's pretty clear to me I'm not gonna make it through the whole list of themes today, and I'm gonna have to continue next week. But why don't, before we take off, you know, I want us to all do something together. And it's a simple form of meditation called counting. I call it the first tool. So it's a very simple tool to help you synchronize your body, your mind, and your spirit. It's very easy. You can do it nearly anywhere and anytime you need. The only technologies you need are your hands and your voice. So it's very, very simple, and you can do it anywhere, when you're walking, on a train, at home, or taking a break from the job, whenever you feel stressed out and you need to relax, focus your mind, and synchronize your spirit and your body. So even though it's very ancient, I think it's pretty relevant today. How's that sound? Yeah, if you're still with me, then let's try it out. So let's start with your right hand. And I know this is a little bit weird because it's mirrored for you all, but try it with your right hand. It doesn't really matter. I can tell you a little bit later. There are some ways to do it differently. But imagine your right hand, okay? And to count, to use counting, you just need to think about every segment of your finger as a different number. Imagine a clock turning. So if we do that, we can start here. We can go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Now, why don't you say it with me? Say it out loud and try it with your hand, and it'll help everything to synchronize. So let's try it again to practice. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Great. Now, if you've got two hands, then it also means you have two digits. So we can think of the left hand as doing the exact same motion, just in the opposite direction, like counterclockwise. But here, each finger segment isn't just one number, it's actually a tens digit. So we can do it like this. We can say 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, and 100. Why don't you try that with me? Just as a little practice, say it out loud with the numbers. 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, and 100. So let's now just sync these two together. Try, if you can, to count with me, and we'll just count together to 30. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, and so on and so forth until you get to the number you want to reach. I try to count, not every day, nobody can do anything every day, but I try to count to 100 or 120, sometimes 500 or 1,000 at a time. And as you develop, there are lots of other techniques that I can help to show you to make it even more interesting. Well, thank you again for joining me today for the second part of Structures, Describing a System in Real Time. We'll continue next week, same time, same space, with the rest of our themes and keep going. I wish you all a great week in the meantime. Thank you.